Welcome to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. We pray that this message will strengthen and encourage you. Now, here's a message from Pastor Deborah Cobray.
Let's open our Bibles to the book of Hebrews in the 10th chapter. And we're going to be finishing up the 10th chapter soon, probably in the next 2 years or so. And we are in the 11th verse of the 10th chapter, and I'm going to read until verse 14. And it says in the book of Hebrews in chapter 10, verse 11, "And every priest stands ministering daily and offering repeatedly the same sacrifices, which can never take away sin. But this man, after he had offered one sacrifice for sins forever, sat down at the right hand of God. From that time, waiting until his enemies are made his footstool. For by one offering he has perfected forever those who are being sanctified." We'll stop there. And last week, Pastor Luke did a magnificent and brilliant job of teaching us about Jesus Christ, the preeminent Lord, the high priest of our confession, the greater covenant, the greater high priesthood, that he had finished the job and that no one had ever sat down. A priest had never sat down. A high priest had never sat down in the presence of God. But when Jesus said, "It is finished," and he brought his blood to the mercy seat of heaven, he sat down at the right hand of the Father. And the Father quotes out of Psalm 110, "Sit and rule and reign until your enemies are made your footstool." And from there, Luke jumped into spiritual warfare. And so this morning, I'd like to just go into another fragment of that, because it's a huge topic and we could actually teach on spiritual warfare for a long, long time, but I'm only going to touch on it today. And it's just pretty much a basic message on warfare. But because I have been used of God and been privileged to be a pastor with my husband and to plant this church and to see God move, and I've traveled the nations and spoken in many, many places, and I've seen God do miracles and signs and wonders, and I've watched God, and because I was as a child raised up, my mother took me to church, and she was a wonderful Baptist. I love the Baptist denomination. Do I have any Baptists in here? Are there any in here? Would you dare raise your hands in this Pentecostal church? I praise God for Pastor Norris, who's with Jesus now and who taught me so much and the Word, and I memorized Scripture. And then when my youth, and when I was 16 and I rebelled for 10 years and got off into drugs and did some horrific things, and I wasn't one of those kids that can say, "Well, it's because of my past." I was just rebellious, and I was just a bad girl. And here comes the mercy of God, and the Word says that to whom much is forgiven, there is much love. And I was that woman at the well, and that woman that washed the feet of Jesus, and he washed me and cleansed me and saved me to the uttermost. I met my husband, and here we are today, 35, 36 years later, never dreaming in a million years we would have ever pastored such a wonderful church. But I'm here to tell you, as a living witness, as a living memorial now in my older years, that God is faithful and that God has won this war, and that you and I are engaged in a battle, but the battle is a good battle because it's a fight that we win. It's a fight of faith, and that if we'll not leave the battle, if we'll not grow discouraged and stop, you will see God do the miraculous in your lives. You'll see God change the city, shake the nations, and bring in the day of the Lord and do what he says he's going to do. Because God is faithful and because God is good. And he waits for a generation to rise up and believe him. And so we saw last week that God told us to put on our armor. And he told us what the armor was. And so this week I want to jump off there, and I want to go to I'll be in 1 Peter, I'll be in the book of James. So let's go to the book of James, because I'm going to start there. And I'm looking at the clock because I'm a woman. I have a lot of words. And I'm going to try to keep this very brief. All the saints of God said, amen. But spiritual warfare is a very real thing. And it says in the book of James, if you can go there with me, in James chapter 4, and if you'll look with me in James chapter 4, it says in verse 5, "Or do you think that the scripture says in vain, the spirit who dwells in us yearns jealously? But he gives more grace. Therefore, he says, God resists the proud, but gives grace to the humble. Therefore, submit to God, resist the devil, and he will flee from you. So right there is the basic training of spiritual warfare. Luke taught us about the armor and the weapon, the sword of the spirit and the shield of faith. But the actual basic training of spiritual warfare begins in James when it says, humble ourselves under the mighty hand of God. Submit to God, resist the devil, and he will flee. This is warfare 101. If this is basic training in the spirit realm, this would be boot camp. Are you with me? And so I wanted to look at that this morning, and I wanted to just, most of you, especially in the first five rows, you could preach this better than I could. But as we move on back, I want to remind you, or I want to share with you some experiences and some things I've lived in and seen God do in my life, and talk about this warfare, because from this, I have watched God take our family, which was a broken family. Jim was divorced. I was divorced. I had an ex-husband who had gotten us into a drug culture, and Jim had been divorced three times before he was 25, and everybody left him, and he was a broken man, and he played professional baseball, and he had failures in his life. So here's two losers, literally two losers. And God takes these two people that were losers and the most unlikely people to ever, ever see God do anything in their lives. And he trains us in the Word of God. And he raises us up to pastor in a city that would be called a losing city. A city that people move out of, they don't move to. Jim and I were in Santa Barbara last week because that's where we met. And I remember so clearly as we were starting the rock that our head usher had lunch with Jim, and Jim was sharing the testimony, and he looked at him with all sincerity and he said, man, what did you ever do to make God so mad that he moved you from Santa Barbara to San Bernardino? But God called us to a broken city because God does his best work with broken people and broken lives. And God loves to show himself strong on behalf of the weak. And so if we'll look at this, I can share with you from some life experience that this stuff works, that it's a good fight. It's a long fight. We're in a war. You're not going to get out of this war until you close your eyes here and open them in heaven. And then you're coming back with the warrior king. So it's still going to be warfare. And sorry. This just distracted me. It's the woman in me, you know, cleaning house. So we've got to get into the war, whether you're cleaning house and wiping butts and being a mom, or whether you're in the marketplace, or whether you are a professor in a college, whatever it is life's work has you doing, you are going to be fighting a fight of faith and fighting in this warfare. And how do we do this? How do we win these battles? Listen, there's going to be times in your lives when there's going to seem like you've lost a battle. It's going to seem like you have just failed. But that doesn't mean you've lost the war. It just means that maybe you lost a skirmish. But if you get back in the fight, you're going to overcome and you're going to see Jesus do amazing things in your life. So everybody's in different places in here, but let's look and see what God says. So there are four things this morning I want to look at about basic training and winning the battle. And the first one that I had to learn, and I'm still learning, is I have to know my enemy. I've got to know how this thing works, because it doesn't work like it does in the natural world. In the natural world, we have laws of physics, we have natural laws, we have civil laws, and we have all of these different things, and I've got to know how to operate in those. I have to know how to stop at a stop sign, stop at a red light. I've got to learn the laws of this nation, the driving laws. But in the kingdom, there's a whole different set of rules and laws, and Satan doesn't play according to your rules or my rules. So I've got to know how this fallen serpent battles and what he does. And it says in 2 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 11, it says, lest Satan should take advantage of us, for we are not ignorant of his devices. Now, right there, if Paul is writing to the church and says, we're not ignorant of his devices, he's telling me that I need to be savvy about how the serpent works. So how does he work? How does this thing play out? Well, the first thing is I got to know where he dwells. Now, there's always a little bit of controversy about where Satan lives. Is he cast out of heaven? Is he in hell? Is he on the earth? Is he in the third heaven, the second heaven, the first heaven? And how many heavens are there? And where in the heck is he? Well, don't worry about all of that right now. Let's just look at real simple stuff. The Bible says he dwells in the darkness. He dwells in darkness. Now, darkness is an absence of light, but in the spirit realm, darkness is an absence from God. And it's not about where he dwells, it's about what he dwells in. And Satan works in the darkness. And therefore, it's vital to recognize that where Satan has been banished, it is not limited to the areas outside of humanity. He's not in heaven, but he is allowed to work in areas of darkness. Are you with me? We, as Christians, have been translated out of the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of his dear Son, out of darkness into the kingdom of light. Ephesians 5:8 says that you were once darkness, that I was once dark. I lived in it. I dwelt in it. God was absent from my life. I knew there was a God, but I wasn't serving him. But now you are light in the Lord. Walk as children of the light. So right here, the Bible tells me that I'm to walk in the light as he is in the light, and that I'm a child of the light, that Satan dwells in the darkness. So what has this got to do with tactics and war tactics? Well, if he lives in the darkness, then Satan can traffic in any area of darkness, even the darkness that can still exist in some places of my heart. Wow. Let me say that again. Satan can traffic in any area of darkness, even the darkness that still exists in places in a Christian's heart. So if I'm to not be ignorant of his devices, if I'm to give him no place, and if I am to resist him and know his tactics, then I'm going to have to understand that there is a battle strategy God has given me so that in those vulnerable areas in my life, I can win the war. Now, when you and I get saved, we are instantly cleansed by the blood of Jesus. The blood of Jesus cleanses us from all unrighteousness. We are holy and we are blameless and we are acceptable before the Lord. Instantly, we are translated out of the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of God. And before God, it's just as if we never sinned, justified. We've been looking at that in the book of Hebrews. But there is a process of change that goes into our lives as we walk out and flesh out this salvation that we're walking in. Is there not? We are not the same people that we were 2 years ago or 3 years ago. I mean, I'm not the same Christian I was 26 years ago when I started this church. There is an ongoing transformation as the Word of God and as these things that we're going to talk about begin to enter into my life. That is spiritual warfare. I'm being changed from glory to glory. Now, if the enemy can traffic in any dark area of my life, then if I am blind to those shade spots, do you know what I mean by that? Listen, none of us, is there a perfect person in here right now? Is there one perfect man? His name is Jesus, the man Christ Jesus. And he is transforming us into his image and his likeness, is he not? But we are not perfect, not earth side, we're not perfect yet. So there's going to be things in our personalities. There's going to be habits, strongholds in our minds. There's going to be belief structures. There's going to be behavioral systems. There's going to be personality quirks that we get from our fathers and our fathers and our fathers' fathers. You know, when I had Jessica, she's a spitting image of her dad. Now, I came from a family, we're not germophobic. We don't think about germs. We don't see them. I mean, we're outdoors people. My father was a hunter and killed everything he could get his hands on and ate it. You know, yeah, I'm one of those backwoods people, kind of scary, I know. I married a man that likes to go to the Ritz-Carlton. I married a man that is very clean. And so when I had Jessica just was like her dad. She thinks about germs and she sees things I don't see. My son, who's not here, he takes after the Larsons. He's an outdoor type. He's the outdoor issue. He doesn't see the germs. And see, there was nothing that anybody did to teach Jessie to see germs. She just, it's in her. How many germ people do I have in here? You just see things. You just see things differently than, how many of you little slobos do I have in here? Do I have any slobos? Yeah. Okay, well, the slobo married the germophobic. It was very interesting. My poor husband. But the point is, Jess is like Jim through DNA. The father and the father and the father and the father. There's quirks in all of us. And when we live together and we get close to each other, we see the quirks, don't we? You can see darkness in me probably a whole lot faster than I can. And so sometimes we're fighting battles that we were never meant to fight because they've already been won for us. And that's one tactic of the enemy, is to get us engaged in mountains out of molehills and things. And God says, I've got a strategy for that. So the first one he says is humble yourself under the mighty hand of God. Now, what has humility got to do with the quirks? Oh, I'm so glad you asked. Because it says, humble yourself under the mighty hand of God, that in due time he may exalt you. It says, for he gives grace to the humble. Now, humility, we talk a lot about humility in this church, and we'll talk about it and teach on it until Jesus comes, because it's a huge subject. But let me just say this, humility is the hardest place to go to. It's the toughest place to stay at, but it's the place that Jesus loves the most. And the last thing that he did on the earth before he left his people and his disciples, that last meal that he had with them, is he took a towel and he humbled himself and he washed the feet of his servants. And he was teaching them what humility was. Humility isn't thinking less of myself. It's thinking of myself less. It's not about being a worm. It's not about being a nothing. Humility is being dependent on God for everything that you do. There's some words about humility that I'd like to bring to you this morning. If I'm going to humble myself, and I don't want God to humble me because that's a difficult thing. He says, humble yourself. Debbie, you humble yourself. Because when you humble yourself, you're engaging now and stepping into the warfare that's going to win the battle. Well, God, how can that be? Well, first and foremost, Satan is an elevated, prideful spirit. In Isaiah chapter 14, Satan said some things. He was the day star. He was the anointed cherub that God created. And he fell because pride was, he was lifted up in his own heart. He said, I will be like the Most High. I will ascend into the sides of the north. I will be like God apart from God. So pride is independent, selfish desires. Things that I want without God. Pride is confidence in your own ability. Accomplishments. Possessions and positions. Pride is rebellion against God because it attributes to self the honor and the glory due to God alone. Pride is independent, selfish desires. It's the armor of Satan. It's who he is. And in our old nature, we are filled with the pride of life. You can see it everywhere you go. The pride of the arrogance of intellect. Everything we attribute to ourselves instead of giving glory to God. And Jesus said that I am humble and meek. Learn of me. When I humble myself before God, first things first. First things mean that I am dependent on him. And second things, I am honest before him. And third thing about humility, I am repentant with him. So there is a dependency on God, there is an honesty before God, and there is a repentant spirit in the humble heart. Now, how is this going to win the war? Well, let me show you what happens. Satan comes along and he dwells in the darkness. So there's a dark spot in my heart. Let's say I lose my temper, or let's say I open my mouth and say something I shouldn't have said. Let's say something in my personality or my behavior is wrong. And all of a sudden, now I am in sin. I have just hurt somebody's feelings. Or let's say you've got a lust problem and you've just turned on the television and you've watched something you shouldn't watch, or the internet, and you've got a lust problem. Let's say you've got a coveting problem and you're cheating on your taxes and you know you shouldn't, but you're doing it anyway, and you're a Christian. You see, there are still dark spots in our hearts. Can we be honest? So now here's what the enemy does. He'll come in and he'll tell you how bad you are. Well, you shouldn't be doing that. You're a Christian. How can you call yourself a Christian? And you know he's right, right? So the first thing you do is you run away from God. Or you start to step back, or you start to hate yourself, or you dislike yourself, or you get depressed, and you get discouraged, and you think, oh, I shouldn't be doing this, and how can I still be doing this, and or this or that, and all of a sudden, instead of having the joy of the Lord, and the peace of God, and the faith of God, now you are shut down. Spiritual battle. Can I preach? So God says, humble yourself under the mighty hand of God, for God gives grace to the humble. Now grace, God's sovereign, divine ability to get the job done on our behalf when we can't do it. Can you change yourself? The answer to that is no, but God can change us. And when you and I agree with our adversary, humble ourselves before God, God can now say, now I can help you get rid of that thing in your life and change your behavior, and you don't have to be ashamed. All I needed you to do was to be dependent on me, honest about what's going on in your life, and now ask me and cry out for help, and the grace of God comes in and begins to turn your heart and change you so that you can't do that thing anymore, because now you've got the power of God on the inside of you. You've won a battle. You've taken down a stronghold. God says, humble ourselves. It's our first line of defense, and it's our first line of warfare. Because he doesn't play fair. He will get you to hate yourself. He will beat you up. He will tell you how bad you are. How could you do this? How could you do that? And he'll say, there's no hope for you. And you step away, and you step away, and you step away, and you step away from the light into the darkness, and now he has you snared in his battleground, and he takes you out, because the thief comes to steal, to kill, and to destroy. First he will tempt you, then he will absolutely harass you, and then he will condemn you, and then he will destroy you. But God says, oh child, I know you. I know what's going on in your life. I know you do what you do, and I know why you do what you do. But first you got to humble yourself under the mighty hand of God. And to humble myself means I got to fire my defense attorney. You see, I've got a defense attorney that sits on my shoulder that tells everybody else and tells me first why I do what I do, and that I'm right and everybody else is wrong. But you see, when you humble yourself, you're honest. When you humble yourself, you say, shut up. The only defense attorney that's allowed to speak in our lives is the advocate, and his name is Jesus. He's already walked through the temptation. He's already walked through the trial. He's already walked through that place, and he knows how to get us through it. You see, it's not that you do it. God knows what you're doing and what I'm doing. It is no secret to him. And if Satan can keep it dark, keep it hidden, keep it closed up, then we live a hypocritical life. We live a life that could be exposed to the light. We live in fear and we live in isolation. And God says, stop all that foolishness. I know why you do what you do. You don't have to blame everybody else or anybody else. Fire that defense attorney. Just come to me. Depend on me. Be honest with me. Cry out for help. And the power of God, because God gives grace to the humble, will change and help you get through that bad habit, that bad situation, and get you out of it. So God says, first and foremost, humble ourselves. Fire that defense attorney and get honest with God. Number two, submit to God. He says, humble yourself under the mighty hand of God. Submit to God. What does that mean? Submission means unconditional obedience. Ah, oh, God, Lord, it's hard to obey you when my flesh doesn't want to. How many times have you lost weight and gained it back? Is it hard to diet? What is it about food? I mean, it started with Eve, you know? She looked at that fruit. It's interesting, the first temptation went into your mouth, isn't it? We like to eat. And then, as Christians, we stop drinking, we stop doing drugs. I mean, I'm not rolling joints anymore and getting stoned, are you? I hope not. If you are, humble yourself and you'll get through that. So we eat, right? So why is it so hard to not eat? Because my flesh likes it. So why is it so hard to obey God? Because our flesh doesn't want to. Our flesh wants to do what we want to do, the old nature. But God says there's power in obedience. And remember when it said, I started out this message and I said that Satan lives in the darkness. He dwells in the darkness. The word to know our enemy's tactics. And the word of God says, give him no place in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 27. Give him no place. What does that mean? That word place there means opportunity. It means an advantage. Don't give Satan an opportunity or an advantage. We are not trapped in the darkness if we have been born of light. But if we accommodate darkness through the tolerance of sin, we leave ourselves vulnerable to satanic attack. If we accommodate darkness, if we tolerate sin in our lives, and that is why submission means to come under the authority of what God's word says. When I bow my heart and my life to God's word, then suddenly power is released into my life. The Bible is filled with examples of this. But one of my favorite examples, one of the most striking examples of this is in the book of Joshua. And it happened to Israel when they were taking the promised land. And it's in the book of Joshua in the Old Testament. And if you'll go there with me, obedience coming under God's authority brings power. We're talking about battles. We're talking about winning battles. Why am I not winning? Why are things happening in my life the way they are? Well, you're in a battle, but it could be that you're not seeing victory because there's something in your life you're not doing that God's told you to do. There's disobedience. And when there's disobedience, there's a dark place and Satan lives in the darkness and I'm back in his court on his battlefield and I have no power. Are you with me? Now, let me just tell you the quick story of what happened here. Joshua has crossed the promise, crossed the River Jordan. He's taken the new generation into the promised land. All of a sudden, they've taken out Jericho. The walls have come down, and now everything's been finished. God said, don't touch anything in Jericho. Don't take any silver. Don't take any gold. Don't take any animals. It's unclean. It's defiled. Don't touch anything in Jericho. And they destroyed Jericho. They destroyed everything that had breath except Rahab and her family. And now they're ready to go to the next city, which is Ai. And it's a small city. It's a very small city. So Joshua sends two spies, a couple of spies out. They come back. They say, listen, don't engage the whole army. We don't need to. Send about 3,000 men and we'll take this. It's no problem. So they send 3,000 men to Ai, and all of a sudden, this small city overcomes and overwhelms them, wipes out 36 people, and they run back to Joshua in defeat. Joshua and all the elders rip their clothes, throw dust on their heads, they fast and they seek God all day long, and they are having a bad moment with God. And Joshua says in Joshua, the 7th chapter, to God, Joshua tore his clothes, fell to the earth, on his face, put dust on his head, and he says in verse 7, alas, Lord God, why have you brought this people over the Jordan at all to deliver us into the hand of the Amorites to destroy us? Oh, that we had been content and dwelt on the other side of the Jordan. And see what happens in disobedience. He doesn't know what's going on yet. But he's now saying, I shouldn't have come over here. I should have just been content to just stay behind the Jordan, just to stay back here where we all were in the wilderness. You see, when you lose some battles because of disobedience, the first thing that happens in your life is you want to retreat and you want to go backward and you don't want to take ground because you've gotten your nose bloodied and you don't know why. And so you want to go backward and you want to say, we should just stay here. We shouldn't risk anything. We shouldn't try this again. And instead of taking ground and taking out the enemy, we want to retreat. And I love what God says to Joshua. So the Lord says to Joshua in verse 10, get up. Remember, he's on the floor wailing and crying to God. Why do you lie thus on your face? Joshua, you've just seen me as the Lord of the warrior armies. You've just taken out Jericho. Why are you acting like this? And God goes on to tell Joshua what has happened, that someone in the camp has taken the things that God said not to take. And this is what God says. Therefore, the children of Israel, in verse 12, could not stand before their enemies, but turn their backs before their enemies because they have become doomed to destruction. Neither will I be with you anymore unless you destroy the accursed from among you. So God says, I can't be with you because of sin. because you disobeyed me. That's why one little thing stopped the whole plan of God. And God says, humble yourselves. Submit to God. Come under authority to God's word. Obey. Why? Because he knows that it's the little foxes that steal and rob the fruit off the vine. And he knows it's those little things in our lives that if we tolerate and we accommodate, that before you know it, we're going to be retreating and retreating and retreating. And the power of God that should be in our lives isn't there. So long story short, they found out who had taken the ungodly things, and they destroyed them and their children and everything they owned. And Israel was again able to reign over their enemies. But what is God saying? He says, submit to God. Come under the authority of the word of God. Obey. If you are having defeat in your life, what is the last thing God told you to do? The word told you to do. What is that last thing? Go back and start doing it and start obeying and watch God turn this thing around. And it means a lot. There's a lot of things in the word of God. Some of you are daydreaming and you come in here and you hear the word of God. It says, receive with meekness the engrafted word, for it has the power to change your souls. But be doers of the word and not hearers only, deceiving ourselves. When you hear the word of God, you are now responsible to do it. And when I don't do it, I am deceiving myself. I have just entered into deception. Deception says, you think you're right, but you're wrong. And I go along my merry way, and I wonder why I'm not being blessed and I'm not winning battles. Could it be that there is darkness that we are accommodating and tolerating? So God says, submit to God. The last thing about submission that I want to touch on really quickly is surrender. The greatest battle that was ever won was in surrender. And submission surrenders its will to God, and that was through Jesus Christ. Let me read this to you. The greatest battle that was ever won was not by confrontational warfare, but by surrender. When Jesus went to the cross, he was fully surrendered to God's purpose and will. He won the battle, not by confrontation, but by surrender. I want out of this marriage. Oh, really? Maybe God wants you to stay in it and do what he says to do. I want to cheat on my taxes. I have to. I don't have any money. Well, maybe God says, render unto Caesar the things that are Caesar. I'm not going to tithe. Well, maybe God says, give, and it'll be given unto you. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over. Are you hearing what I'm saying? It's the everyday things in our lives that we hear and we hear and we hear and we don't do that God is saying, that could be stumbling you. Know the tactics of your enemy. Don't accommodate or tolerate darkness in our lives. Submission means obedience and surrender. And the last one today, and we'll finish with this. He says, humble yourselves under the mighty hand of God. God gives grace to the humble, honest, dependent, and repentant. Then he says, submit, obey, and surrender. And then he says, resist the devil, and he will flee. So that's all warfare. So what does that mean to resist? Resistance means, it's a word, hupomino, it means to hold one's ground in conflict, to bear up against adversity, to hold out under stress, to stand firm, to persevere under pressure, to wait calmly and courageously. It is not passive resignation to fate and mere patience, but the active, energetic resistance to defeat that allows calm and brave endurance and victory. God says resist, stand against. Well, how do I do that? How do I stand against? Well, there's a lot of ways to stand against the enemy, but let me just give you one that's worked for me, and that is to pray. Prayer is the actual engagement of the battle. Prayer is the battle. When you pray, you are engaging in the battle that God has called us to. All kingdom ministry is birthed in prayer. All kingdom ministry is sustained through prayer. And all kingdom ministry is victorious because of prayer. And all kingdom ministry means your marriages, your families, our children, our jobs, our churches, our lives. Prayer. Now I want to just show you one more thing and we're going to quit. In Luke chapter 18, Jesus says and tells them a parable, but I love what he says in this. He says in Luke 18, and I'm reading out of the Amplified Bible. Also, Jesus told them a parable to the effect that they ought always to pray and not to turn coward, to faint, lose heart, and give up. So Jesus says, don't stop praying. You're always to pray and not to stop praying. And I don't know about you, but sometimes I stop praying. I lose a battle and I stop praying. I lose some skirmishes and I stop praying. My flesh doesn't want to pray. Sometimes I don't pray. But Jesus said, don't stop praying. So if he said not to stop praying, I guess that means, Debbie Cobray, don't you stop praying. That means, Rock Church, don't you stop praying. And he gives us this parable, and it's a lesson in contrast, not in similarities. Now watch what he says. He says, in a certain city, there was a judge who neither reverenced and feared God nor respected or considered man. There was a widow in that city who kept coming to him and saying, protect, defend, and give me justice from my adversary. For a time he would not. But later he said to himself, though I have neither reverence for God or fear God nor respect or consider man, yet because this widow continues to bother me, I will defend and I will protect and I will avenge her, lest she give me intolerable annoyance and wear me out by her continual coming, or at the last she come and she flip out and she rail on me and she takes out a gun and she shoots up my courthouse, or she assaults me or strangles me. Well, I might have added a few things there. Then the Lord said, listen to what this unjust judge says. And will not our just God, remember, this is not a lesson in similarities, this is a contrast. Unjust judge, just God. Unjust judge, just God. Will not our just God defend, protect, and avenge his elect, his chosen ones, who cry to him day and night? Will he defer them and delay help on their behalf? I tell you, he will defend and protect and avenge them speedily. However, when the Son of Man comes, will he find persistent faith on the earth? Could it be that Jesus is saying, as the day approaches, and as it's been a long time since his crucifixion and resurrection, could it be that the church of the 21st century will stop praying and will not be passionate in prayer and will back off a little bit and will say, well, I guess it's okay here. We'll just start to tolerate. We'll just start to live with. We'll just start to accommodate. The way life is, it is what it is. When the Son of Man returns, will he find faith on the earth? Will there be a praying church? This church was birthed in prayer. Everything that ever happened good in this church is because we prayed. Because we believed God. Mansions were given to us. Miracles happened in this church. People were saved and the altar call was given because somebody was willing to pray it through. There was outreach ministries because some people were willing to stand in the gap and begin to pray and listen to what God said. And then God raised up people to go out and do what they had prayed for them to do. You see, prayer is the battle. And when we pray and when we don't stop praying and when we get up in the morning and we begin to decree a thing and we begin to pray and we begin to believe God again and we begin to say, God, this is what your word says. Therefore, as a child of God, I stand in the gap and I release my faith and I believe what your word says. And Father, in Jesus' name, my house shall be saved. My marriage will be healed. And you do what the word says to do to make that come to pass, but you pray. Church, some of us need to get up and pray again. And not stop and double up and triple up and begin to have your midnight prayer meeting with God and your 2 o'clock prayer watch and your 6 o'clock prayer watch and your 5 o'clock prayer watch and your 4 o'clock prayer watch. You need to pray in your car. You need to pray in the shower. You need to pray without ceasing. We need to pray about everything and worry about nothing, but we need to be the church and do what Jesus said, because when he returns, will there be a believing, praying church? And that's what he said. I didn't. So spiritual warfare, it's a good fight of faith, because we win, because he's already won the war. We are enforcing his victory. But it's not going to just happen. It's not going to fall in our laps. We're going to have to know the enemy. We're going to have to do what Pastor Luke said, put on our armor. Every day you put your armor on. You go to bed in your armor. You get up in your armor. Every day when you wake up and when you close your eyes and sleep, you understand who the enemy is. If there is a war and you're in it, baby, and you're not getting out of it, you've been drafted into this war, so you can either be a victorious warrior or you can be a reluctant warrior, but I'd rather be victorious than reluctant. So we might as well get back in the fight and kick some devil butt and take some ground that he's called us to take in our jobs, in our families, in our marriages, in this church, in this city, in this nation, and go into every nation and preach this gospel to hasten the day of the Lord. So know your enemy. 2, humble ourselves under the mighty hand of God. He gives grace to the humble. Honest, dependent, and repentant humility. Submit. Come under the authority of his word. Bow your heart and your life to what he says. And surrender. And shut up that stupid defense attorney that wants to defend the flesh. Shut them up and fire them. And pray like you've never prayed before. Pray without ceasing. Pray about everything. Worry about nothing. And you will win some fights. And you will win what God has called you to win. Take the ground he's called you to take. So you've been great. We're in an awesome time in history. The Lord is near. Jesus is returning. And the day of the Lord is at hand. And everything that I said to you this morning was true. We're to know our enemy. We're to humble ourselves under the mighty hand of God because he gives grace to the humble. To come under the authority of his word and to submit and surrender our lives to him in the big and the little. And to keep praying and to resist the enemy. But none of this works. None of this is going to work if you're not born of the Spirit of God, if you're not born again. And every week at this church, we give an invitation as messengers and witnesses of Jesus Christ out to this congregation and whoever is here to come and be a part of the great family of God. You know, we live in a nation that says that all roads lead to heaven, but they don't all lead to heaven because somebody says something doesn't make it true. It's what God says. And either God is God or he isn't. Either this is all true or none of it's true. God's throne is in heaven and the earth is his footstool. But what makes us think that we're going to get into God's heaven? And whether you want to think about it or not, every one of us are going to die. We're not going to live forever in these bodies. And you are going to separate from this earthly body and you're going to spend eternity somewhere. You're either going to spend eternity in God's heaven or you're going to spend eternity in hell. And God did not make you for hell. He made you for heaven. But how do we get to God's heaven? Well, I want to just quickly tell you, because it's not by being good. I know that we live in culture that tells us good people go to heaven. And isn't that a lovely thought? But that's not true, because God says that his goodness and our goodness are completely different. And his scale of perfection and my scale of perfection isn't even on the same page or in the same book. And God says that my goodness is like a filthy rag before him. I can't be good enough, in other words, to get to heaven. God says you can't work your way into heaven because you couldn't be that good. You would work for the rest of your lives into eternity and you still would never make it. So being good isn't going to get us to heaven. Going to church isn't going to get us to heaven. Even believing that Jesus Christ is the Son of God isn't going to get you to heaven because the devil believes that Jesus is the Son of God and he's not going to heaven. So what does get us to heaven? What actually happens to take us out of darkness and bring us into light? And it's simple, but it's profound. And that's what we've been studying in the book of Hebrews, that God loved this world so much that he wasn't willing that we would perish. So he stepped out of heaven, stepped into the womb of a virgin and became a man and became that last Adam for you and I, went to that cross for you and I, took on the guilt and the shame and the sin of every one of our wrongdoings. All humanity, Jesus Christ took on at that cross. And he says, if we will look to that cross and believe that he is the Son of God, that he died for us, that he was raised from the dead, and that he's seated at the right hand of the Father, if you'll believe that, and here's the second thing, if you will surrender your life and your heart to him, letting him be Savior and Lord, and Lord means boss. Then he says, you'll be saved. It's that simple. He's done all the work, but he can't force himself into the human heart. He invites himself in, but you and I have to open up our lives and tell him to come and take our life and be our Savior and be our Lord. When you do that, when you surrender all of your heart and all of your life to him, he takes you out of the kingdom of darkness, and instantaneously he brings you into the kingdom of God. And from the inside out, you are born again, and everything begins to change. Doesn't mean you're always going to do everything right or you understand everything. It just means that you've started on this journey with God, with Jesus as Lord and Savior. Now, God brought you here this morning for a very specific reason, and he brought you here if you are not born again and not saved and have not surrendered all of your heart and all of your life to him. He brought you here to do that today. You see, no one can say Jesus Christ is Lord apart from the Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit's already been talking to your heart, already been speaking to you, already been dealing with you. You've already had all of these thoughts and all of these feelings. That's why you're here. And God brought you here today to change your destiny. So all over this auditorium, if you've been running from God instead of to God, I'm talking to you. You're here today for destiny. All over this auditorium, if you've been a good person and you've tried to do the right things, but you failed over and over. You've been to church, but you've never surrendered your heart and your life to Jesus Christ, asking him and inviting him in to be your Savior and your Lord. I'm talking to you. All over this auditorium, if you've one time served God, but now you've backslidden and you've gone away and you're here today because you know you need to get right with God, I'm talking to you too. So if you've never surrendered all of your heart and all of your life to Jesus Christ, you're here today for that reason. And God's inviting you home today. He's not mad at you. He loves you. He knows exactly what you're into. He's not in shock over your sin. He's not in shock over your lifestyle, but he is inviting you to come and believe and let his son, Jesus Christ, become Savior and Lord of your life. So this is what we're going to do. All over this auditorium, I'm going to count to three, and I'm going to ask you with heads up and eyes open to raise your hand if you're not right with God and you need to get right. Some of you are saying, oh, I don't want to do that. I'm going to be embarrassed. Well, that's just tough. Isn't that just too bad? You know why? Because if the Son of God, of God himself, can stay on that cross naked and bloody and be a spectacle for you and I, then in the safe, loving church that has prayed for you and wants you here, you can raise your hand with all of us and say, yes, I need to get right with God. Don't let the enemy put one moment of hesitation in your life, because this is your destiny. Some of you are saying, well, I'm going to be embarrassed. We've already covered that. You won't be. Jesus said, if you confess me before men, I'll confess you before my Father. But if you deny me, I'll deny you. You see, if you can't walk an aisle, how are you going to walk out those doors and live for Jesus Christ in a hostile world? We love you here, but most of all, God loves you here, and he brought you here today. So I'm going to count to three. I'm just going to hit the pulpit. I'm just going to ask you all together just to lift your hand if you need to get right with God. Are you ready? One, two, three. Let me see your hands all over this auditorium. I see that hand. 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 Let's do this, because I didn't put my glasses on. I don't know where they are. I really can't see any more hands. They're all going up, but you're all a big blur. So what we're going to do is we're going to stand up. We're going to sing this song. If you raised your hand, or if you didn't and you know you should have, slip out of your seat quickly. Bring your Bible, your purse, whatever you brought to church with you. Come meet me quickly at this aisle. Let's get right with God. It's not too late if you didn't raise your hand. Just come down with everybody else. Let's get right with God this morning. Jesus is the only way to God. He is the only way. He's the only way. He loves you. He loves you. He loves you. But he won't force himself in. He asks you to come and open your heart. Surrender all your heart and all your life to him. Quickly come. Quickly come. Quickly come.
Come receive.
Quickly. They're still coming. Some of you are hesitating. Don't hesitate. You you have today, you don't have tomorrow. God brought you here today to change your destiny.
Just taste the living water.
Look up at me. Your angels are having a party right now. They are dancing however angels dance. I have no idea how they dance. But it says that when one comes to the Lord, there is a party in heaven. They love you. You're not going to a funeral. You're going to a birthday party. Yours. This is Pastor Joel. If you'll make a turn this way, if you'll make a left-hand turn this way, follow Pastor Joel. We're going to pray with you. Your loved ones can meet you in the room right over here. Nothing weird's going to go on for the sake of time.
Hey, you just heard that altar call. You just wanted to give God all of your heart and all of your life. Now let me lead you simply in a prayer of inviting Jesus Christ into your heart as your Lord and Savior. In fact, why don't you just go ahead and listen to me and go ahead and close your eyes and just repeat these words after me. I'll go slow. You repeat them. Say these words. Say, Father God, I come to you in the name of Jesus. I believe that Jesus Christ is your only begotten Son, and that you sent him for me, and that he died for me on that cross at Calvary. I believe that his blood washes away my sins, that I am now a new creature in Christ Jesus. And I thank you, Lord. I receive you now and forever as my Lord and as my Savior. I'm going to turn from sin, and I'm going to turn with all of my heart and all of my life to you, Jesus, as my Lord and as my Savior. Let it be known in heaven as well as upon the earth that I am born again. I'm a child of God, that I'm saved, and I'm headed for heaven and denying my presence in hell. Thank you, Jesus. I'm alive forevermore. Love you so much. God bless you guys. Everybody just say amen and receive Christ as your Lord and Savior. So talk to you later. God bless you.
Thank you for listening to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. If this message spoke to you, please share it with us. We'd love to hear from you. You can find more information at www.rockchurch.com.